Well, I've already, I guess I realize I've already gotten into 3.3 somewhat, because that's arc length curvature. So I've already told you what arc length is. We already saw that the arc length of a curve from A to B, that is to say from T equals A to T equals B, is really the antiderivative of the speed function. We also saw that if you take take the arc length and make it a function of t, starting at say zero, it doesn't have to be zero actually, but starting at say zero, which is as good a point as any, up to t, then you can see how I can take this integral to find the length of the arc from t equals zero up to any given point. And this is also useful when you're wanting to reparameterize something. Of course, I've already said that in general, if I just make up random functions for R, for X, Y, and Z, like actually computing this could be impossible, if not monstrously difficult.
Yeah.
So in general, we don't literally do that. In general, what we do is we just say, well, according to fundamental theorem of calculus, the derivative would be r prime at t. And this is going to be useful. In fact, this is what we're going to do. In order to make sense out of curvature, right, which I have defined to be the derivative of the unit tangent function with respect to the arc length, and it's the magnitude of that. In order to make sense of this definition, right, I'm going to be using this. I'm going to be using the arc length without actually computing the arc length. This is one of those ways of avoiding the messiness. Now, this is the definition of curvature, right? But you will rarely, perhaps never, actually use this formulation of the definition, right? This is the only part I have memorized because it's easy to remember.
I was going
to
say, it looks easy.
It's concise, it's to the point, yeah. Right? We're going to have two other formulas for curvature, and they're a bit more longer and involved. I wouldn't want to have to memorize them. But to answer your questions regarding them, you're going to have to memorize either the derivation or the formula itself, whatever's, you pick your poison, so to speak, right? There's another one. It looks like this. Let's see if I'm gonna see if I can do this from memory, because I was just reviewing it recently. So let's think about it. Okay. So I know that the tangent vector given by the unit tangent vector given by parameter t, not necessarily the arc length, just an arbitrary parameterization, would be found by taking the derivative of r.
Divided by the magnitude.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay. And I know that that's theoretically possible. We saw at least one example of that. And so that being the case, I believe I can do something fancy like this. What I'm about to do is take the derivative with respect to t. Alright? What I want to do is take the derivative with respect to little t of the left-hand side and the right-hand side. The right-hand side will be a little easier than the left-hand side. The left-hand side is a little complicated because it's a product. Right-hand side is easy. That's just going to be
Okay. Yeah.
That.
Dragon.
That wasn't so bad. Left hand side. I've erased it. It was written about right here about an hour ago. But there are some properties, right, of these functions. And we have three types of product rules. They ended up looking the same, but they're saying different things. One of them was when you had a normal function. By normal, I mean like regular, like real value function, multiplied by a vector value function. So it's a scalar multiplication. The other one was like a vector value function multiplied by a dotted with a vector value function, then a vector value function crossed with a vector value function. Which of those three am I using here?
Well, the absolute, the magnitude of r of t, that's just the scalar, right?
Right.
Yeah. So, yeah. And, but the tangent vector is the vector.
Yeah. So yeah, you got to kind of think it through, but you can see how r is going from r to rn, let's say. I'll keep it in, I'll just say it's three space. Whatever you want it to be.
One.
That's wrong.
So r prime, since you're just taking derivative of each of those coordinates, is also going to be going from here to here. And for that reason, when you compute the unit tangent vector, because you're just taking this and dividing it by a scalar, that's also going from like this. But the speed, this function, is taking this function and all these vectors, we're just turning it into a scalar. So this, although it doesn't look like it, is a function as you know it from differential calculus. All right. So you're right. We're going to be using the product rule on the left-hand side, but it's going to be a scalar times a vector, right? Which is going to be of the form t prime at t times the magnitude of r prime at t plus t as a function of t. And I know what I want to say, but it's the derivative of that. Right?
The derivative of what?
Of this.
Oh, yeah.
Using the product rule, right?
Right.
And I didn't leave myself much space, but I'm just going to say d dt of r prime of t. And you got to be careful here because it would be tempting at this step
to write r double prime.
Yeah. But that wouldn't be quite
That's what right. I wanted to do.
Yeah. We're not going to do that.
Dragon.
Mostly because it wouldn't be true.
Mostly because you're wrong.
Yeah. So there's that. And T cross R, R cross R. I believe what I want to do, if I'm kind of going on memory now, because this next step is kind of, at least for me, unintuitive, right? So I'm just doing it just because I saw it written. Let me copy this down because it's looking a little squished. So t prime, and of course by t prime, hopefully it's clear, that's the derivative of t with respect to lowercase t, right?
Right.
This is just what it is, plus this, yeah. Actually, I think what they do in the book is they call that the derivative of the speed. You know what I mean? I'll just leave it like this. I think it's more intuitive just leave it like that. And actually, let me leave myself a little space. Going to do is I'm going to compute the cross product of this with far as I know, I'm not a specialist in these things, but that just seems like it's out of the blue. I'm not really sure what the motivation was for it, but it just works. But if it, in the next couple steps, you start to see why. It's like playing chess, you know? It's like, you know, someone makes a move and you're like, why did he do that?
Yeah.
And it becomes clear in the next couple moves. Oh, that's why. Now that I'm losing. Right?
Now that it's over.
Yeah. We've, you know, in the last section, I think even in the last chapter on cross products, there's a whole list of properties of cross products, right? We didn't really go into them in detail, although you might have played around with some of those in the homework. It wasn't on any of the homework that I had you hand in, though. But there's properties of the cross product. For example, this is a sum crossed with this vector. It's a sum of two vectors, in parentheses, crossed with that vector. One of the properties of cross products is it's kind of like the distributive property. It works just like distribution. So I'm going to get t prime of t times r prime of t crossed with r prime of t plus t dt of r prime of t cross with r prime of t, r double prime of t cross with r prime of t. So that's the distributive property for cross products. And that's something, you know, in a more rigorous course, you'd have to prove that you can even do that. Fortunately, we get it free. And I think it's in this next step that we start to see why taking the cross product of r prime was a bright idea. If we focus on this first term on the left, inside the parentheses, what I have is a vector times a scalar,
right,
crossed with another vector. Now, if you have a scalar in there, one of the properties of the cross products is you can factor the scalar out. Okay? So in other words, I can rewrite this as the scalar times the cross product of t prime and r prime. And of course the derivative of this is a scalar to this, the derivative of real value function. So by that same reasoning, I can pull it out. And I can kind of look at these cross products a little more closely now, here and here. One of them is zero.
Say again.
Between this cross product and that cross product, I claim one of them is zero. How do you know which one's zero?
I don't know which one is zero.
Under what circumstances is the cross product the zero vector?
Remember when they're parallel?
Yeah.
Yeah.
With the dot product, it's a zero.
If they're perpendicular.
With the right. Cross product, this you get this not zero but the zero vector.
Right.
When they're parallel. Right?
So I can't tell which one's how can I tell which one is parallel?
Well remember that t itself is going in the same direction as r prime.
Oh, right. Yeah. Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
This has just been like either lengthened or shortened to
the same. Yeah.
So these two vectors are going in the same direction.
Yeah.
That is the zero vector.
Zero. Okay.
And this scalar times the zero vector is a zero vector.
Yeah.
This whole term disappears.
I like that.
It's pretty nice. this one can also be simplified, but for a little trickier reason to see why. If, let's see here, yeah, I guess I never really mentioned this. If, I think I did actually mention it at some point in time, a week or two ago, as a passing, you know, thing, just because I was anticipating this moment. And that is this, so I, you know, a vector is different from a real value function in that it carries with it magnitude and direction.
Right.
A real value function just has magnitude, basically.
Right.
Direction, if you think of it, it's positive and negative, but
yeah.
But it's much more of a refined sense of direction now.
Right.
It's not just in a one-dimensional direction. It's like two-dimensional, right?
Right.
Or three-dimensional even. So when you take the derivative of a vector value function, it's the change in the whole package. It's a change in the magnitude as well as a change in direction, all wrapped up
right.
in one.
Okay.
That makes sense?
Yeah.
And so when you take the derivative of a unit tangent vector, you've removed, right? It's like you've removed the sense of distance, and it's just take finding the change in direction alone.
The magnitude is.
Yeah. Exactly. And so I'll draw a picture that you've probably seen like in your physics class, right? Which is, what if I have, if I'm going along a circle, this is something you would see in your physics class when you're talking about centripetal motion, you know? If you're going around a circle at a constant speed, right? There's a, even though you're moving at a constant speed, you're accelerating. Right?
Right, yeah. If it's
you're not accelerating in the sense of going faster,
right.
But you're accelerating in the sense that, because going faster means like there's a change in like your speed.
Yeah.
But there's acceleration in the sense of a change in direction. So in the vector sense, you're accelerating, right? And you can feel it, because if you're like inside of like a little like pod that's like going around in a circle, you would feel this force pushing you against the side of the wall, you know?
Right.
And so that acceleration translates into a force in the Newton's first law sense of the word, you know? Force equals mass times acceleration. Mm. You know, there's an acceleration, and even though you're not in a linear sense speeding up or slowing down, there's a you can experience an actual force.
Right.
Right? And if you were to, and the way you would compute that is, let's say I pick a point like maybe right here, you'd find the unit, you know, like the tangent vector there. And if I go right here, if I'm going at the same speed throughout, there'd be another vector right here. And to compute the derivative, right, then you would subtract these two vectors, right? Let me see if I can get this right. That is to say, I would take this vector, oops, and then put these like so that they're the tails are right on top of each other.
Okay.
And this vector right there. I should draw it bigger. Let me draw it bigger so it's easier to see. This vector, I'm going to magnify it. It's still the same length, I'm just looking at it closer.
Mark.
Try. And this vector is right here. But it's actually, the tail is actually a little further along the circle. So that when I subtract them, if I were trying to take the derivative, then I'm taking the difference quotient. I'm subtracting these vectors and dividing by h. When I subtract those vectors, what I get is this vector right here. You see?
Mm-hmm.
And so what I get, if you look at a, if you take the, as h gets closer and closer to zero, what you end up with is a vector towards the center of the circle. Long story short,
man.
If you're going along a circle, right?
Yeah.
And again, that's only if I'm going at a constant speed. So if you're traveling along the circle at a constant speed, then your acceleration vector would be directed towards the center of the circle. Right? In other words, it would be perpendicular to my tangent vector. Now, if my speed is changing, then it won't be pointing to the center. It might be pointing this way or that way,
yeah,
a little bit away. But,
yeah,
but if it's going at a constant speed, then yeah, that's what it would be. And so, yeah, so these are going to be perpendicular to each other. And so for that, and notice that capital T prime, right? See how I've shrunk it down so that it has a constant speed. It's always a unit length.
Right.
You know what I mean? So it's always going at the same speed, but as it rotates, this is gonna be perpendicular to R prime. This is gonna be, if I was to label it on here, this would be R prime. And this right here would be T prime. You see that? And so then the cross product of perpendicular vectors would be what?
The cross product perpendicular.
So T prime and R prime are perpendicular, or I'm not sure if I should say perpendicular or normal. I'll just say perpendicular, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
These are perpendicular. So
that means. Yeah. This is not English, who cares? Yeah.
Yeah. So that means that the length of the cross product?
Yeah.
Would be, and I know we did cover this before, it's the magnitude of T prime times the magnitude of R prime times the sine
between them.
So of the angle in between them. But the angle in between them in this case is?
Pi over 2.
Yeah.
So, 1.
Yeah. So it simplifies nicely. And in fact,
T prime dot R times.
It might be worth remembering. Well, that the length of the unit tangent vector, right? Let's see here. Is this true? Let's see here. I believe that the absolute value of T prime, or I should say the magnitude of T prime, is 1.
Yeah. Wait, how's it 1?
Well, T is 1,
yeah,
by definition,
right,
as a length of 1. And then when you take the derivative of it, then you would have, I guess I could just look at, maybe I can convince you with like a, just a computation, right?
Right.
So this vector has length 1.
Okay. Yeah.
And then if I take the derivative of it, call this T, right? Actually, this is R, so R prime would be negative sine
cosine,
and the length of this vector is also 1, so that means that this is also capital T of T, right? So capital T prime would be negative cosine of T, negative sine. And that also has length 1. Okay, this doesn't prove it, but I'm just showing you the case.
I can see it there. But.
Yeah. Let's see here. Why is it 1? I want you to see. That's one example to show why it is true in that case. Let's see here. So because I think I can prove that, actually.
We can save the proof for later. I'm still pretty interested in this certain thing.
Yeah, yeah. Well, let me just double check to make sure I'm not lying to you, though. Because I'm kind of going from memory here, and I'm pleased with what I've remembered so far. length and curvature. We have all this business. Very nice. So, yep. Proof. So we take the cross product, and it says here, T prime is parallel to N, T is orthogonal to N, it follows a T. So T cross T prime. Right, okay. Yeah, they just prove it. So yeah, so just real quick. They took the cross. If you take T cross with T prime. So notice that T is going in the same direction as R prime.
T is going, okay, yeah.
And T prime is going in the, is perpendicular. So T prime is perpendicular. Yeah, so I guess by this I can also say T prime and T, right? Are perpendicular.
That's right.
So that means that some, it's kind of like the same argument that I'm using from here, just for T and T prime. So that means that the length of this vector would be the length of T times the length of T prime times the is the cross product, so it's the sine of the angle in between them, and the angle between them again is pi over 2. And that, of course, the unit tangent vector by definition is 1.
Yeah.
Try so that means that this right here is just going to be that.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And so, yeah. I guess that's all I need. Oh, yeah. I don't. T prime. So I'm going to take T cross R. Oh, I see what they did. Okay. I see what they did. All right. So this is where we're at right here on this line right here. I'm trying to simplify this. So let me finish that off now. Definition of curvature and all that. So what I have now is this. So this whole thing is zero.
Tracking.
This, right? Right here, we got to this point, and I think I'm just gonna leave this as that, actually. I'm just gonna leave it as that. So what I can see now is that R prime of T times, I'm going to leave it like this for now, because I'm not looking at the magnitude of the cross product yet. Get this. This vector equals that vector.
It's hard for me to write and like keep up with what you're saying. I'm pretty much done writing. I'm just gonna take pictures and write later.
Yeah, you can see how as I go from here to here, the only thing that's really changed is that this term has disappeared.
Yeah, zero.
Right. I did leave off these parentheses, but I think it's still clear. But this is a vector equaling another vector, and I want to now take the magnitude of this vector. Now this is a scalar, it's a positive scalar in fact. So that can actually come out. Magnitude of T prime crossed with R prime. and that, because these vectors are perpendicular to each other, it's going to just come down to just this product right here, right? And Okay. This is the same as that.
Yeah.
And I'm going to divide it through.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. Cool.
Yeah. Now the goal is, what I'd like to know is the derivative of t, not with respect to little t, but the derivative of t with respect to little s.
The derivative of t with respect to little s.
Yeah.
Okay.
The way I'm going to do that is a chain rule. That's going to be the derivative of t with respect to little t, the parameter. All right. Divided by the derivative of f with respect to little t.
Yeah, okay, I see. Yeah.
See that right there?
Yeah.
And that's just going to be so this is a derivative of t with respect to little t.
Yeah.
And I just erased it. It was right here just a moment ago. But what I erased was this. S prime and t.
Oh, yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah.
So to get the curvature, all I have to do is just divide those two. This divided by that. So the curvature is r double prime cross with r prime all over r prime squared.
Oh, cube. Oh. Yeah, because it's
R. Wow. Okay, so that was the first formula is this one. And it was a no small feat to come up with that formula. But this one's going to be more useful when you're actually trying to compute a number
for
a curvature. Final formula, and this final formula, I don't think it's worth memorizing, because it actually, if you have this, it's actually not that much work to derive the one I'm about to write. It's actually pretty almost immediate, right? But this one is actually, I think, worth memorizing, because if you had to reinvent it every time you needed it,
it's pretty rough.
That's pretty rough. Yeah. So, but like, if I want to like kind of like just go back to just nice, friendly, two-dimensional graphs, you know? Things like you saw in differential calculus.
That's where I want to go.
Yeah. Things like this, where you have like a function looks like that. I used to draw those types of graphs every day.
Yeah.
Right? It's been a while. But yeah, if I want to now find the curvature at a particular point, see how the curvature, I would say, is pretty low right here? It's pretty great right here.
Mm-hmm.
Right? The way I would do that, now, back when we were doing differential calculus, we were just doing this from a function, a real value function point of view. But we could actually backtrack to everything we did in the differential calculus and do it all in terms of vectors. You know?
Yeah.
Like for example, so back in the day, we would have said this.
Yeah. Simple stuff.
Yeah. But you know, I could, now that we have some new tools at our disposal, you could parameterize it in terms of t, where x is t and y is f of t. And that would have the same exact graph.
Maybe, yeah, it makes sense.
You know what I mean? It's almost like just semantics, but now like it's easy to see that r prime.
One.
And r double prime. And r double prime crossed with r prime. Well, that'll be now. Okay, that required to do a cross product. You need three coordinates. So let's just pretend there's a z-axis coming out, and I have zero, f double prime, and zero,
one,
f prime, and zero. And now I can see that I get zero, zero, and minus f double prime. That's the cross product. It's actually pretty easy in this case. And I'm kind of peeking over here as I construct this, right? I have the numerator. Well, I need the magnitude of this, I guess. But you can see how the magnitude of this guy just the magnitude of this vector. Well, that's just
squared.
Yeah.
Square root of the square.
Oh yeah, that's right. Square root of zero squared.
Absolute value. So, and the magnitude of this guy. That would be the magnitude of this guy. And let's just think of it as a three-dimensional vector. I guess it doesn't matter that much. So in other words, it's going to be 1 plus f prime of t squared to the 3/2 power. So the curvature, this is the third formula now. It's the absolute value of f double prime. All over 1 plus f prime of t squared. You could replace that t with an x if you like, since t stands for x. That's the third formula. So back when we were just beginning to talk about curvature, I think we kind of found the curvature at the vertex. I think we found it to be, I think the oscillating circle was 2, so we said the curvature was, the radius of the oscillating circle was 1/2, so the curvature was 2. But now I have another way of seeing that, right? Because if f of x is x squared, then f prime of x would be 2x, and f double prime of x would be 2. So now I can see that the curvature in general would be the absolute value of 2 over 1 plus 2x squared to the 3/2. And at the origin, that was when x was equal to 0.
Yeah.
So the curvature was 2.
Tracking 0.
So k equals 2 at the origin. Radius of oscillating circle is 1/2. And I think the other question that I kind of stated, but without proof, right, was, actually, I just proposed it. I didn't even like say what the answer was because I didn't know what it was, right? But I can now I can easily see what the curvature is at 1-1, right? That's a point on the curve. I'm expecting it to be smaller than 2. And indeed, at 1-1, I can see that the curvature is 2 over 1 plus...
2 squared?
Yeah.
2 over 3 halves?
So 2 over 5 to 3 halves? Oh, sorry, 3 halves. Whatever that is.
Yeah.
Some kind of a decimal, I'm pretty sure it's less than 2.
It's like, yeah.
Yeah, and I can see that the radius of the oscillating circle would be the reciprocal.
Yeah.
So 5 to the 3 halves over 2. Yeah, that would be the radius of it. And I can, and I have a formula that can tell me what it is everywhere. And furthermore, I claim, right, I'm out of time, but I'll just state it. You can figure it out on your own.
No, I can't.
But I'm just, you know, like if I have this, if f of x equals square root of x instead.
Should be the same.
At 1-1, you're gonna have dealing with a different function. You have to redo all this. But when you plug in 1, you should get the same exact thing. Should be exactly the same thing. So I think the curvature here is also gonna be 2/5 to the 3/2 power. At 1-1 on y equals square root x. That'd be the curvature there. And it also has meaning. You know, we can talk about more ways to interpret this, but if this was a track, the g-forces that you'd feel like pulling you to one side, the same g-forces that you feel like that you would feel pulling you to the other side, if this was a track as well.
Yeah.
I couldn't make that statement with just the second derivative alone.
Right.
You know, so, yeah, so that's pretty cool. Yeah, I think that's it for today.
That's it for this quarter.